Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, y'all, and welcome to Cloud Conversations. I am Azure McFarlane, one of the hosts of the podcast, and I am joined here by my great friend, Kat Greenan, and our guest, Pragati Jain. Welcome, y'all. How are you doing?
Woo!
Good.
Really good. Really, really good. We were just saying before we came on the show, actually, that this is our first female only episode, and also the first where me and Azure have done an episode together, so we're hitting lots of milestones, so we're really, really excited for this one. It's a big one, so make sure you stick in if you're watching now, to this episode. We've got the absolute pleasure of introducing our guest today, Pragati Jain, who is, and I'm going to butcher this, but we'll go for it, a Microsoft Data Platform MVP, event organizer, frequent event speaker, manager at the Power BI UK user group, blogger, and there's just so much more to add to that list. You've been up to a lot of stuff. So
welcome.
That's only scratching the surface. So welcome. It's so lovely to have you on the show. How are you doing?
Thanks, Kat, and thanks, Azure. I'm really excited to be here because for me as well, this is like the first time we are all female on show here, because as you said, I have been involved in many speaking shows and other stuff, but never had that opportunity. Mm-hmm. So quite excited to be here with you guys. Thank
Amazing.
You.
Amazing. Woo! It's a all female party. To start off with, what we always start off with is, are you able to just share a little bit for the audience who might not know who you are, what you're up to, what you're all about, a little bit about yourself, how'd you get into tech, all of that wonderful stuff. That'd be a great place to start.
Yeah, definitely. So those who don't know me, my name is Pragati Jain, everyone. And as Kat introduced me, like, I'm a Microsoft Data Platform MVP. So if I start with the journey, how I got into technology was, I actually started as a database developer like 12 years back. And obviously, I worked as a database developer for like a few years. And then eventually, at that time, analytics was something really coming up quickly in the industry. So I thought, why not try something new and, learn something new in the technology area? So I just went for my master's in data science and analytics. So I came to London, did my master's in data science and analytics. And then after finishing my master's, I started my journey into analytics. So I've worked into analytics as a data analyst for initial 5 years. And I would say not just data analyst, it was more around a consultant role as well. And then last year, I actually took up a new challenge to learn something new apart from my previous experience in analytics. So my previous experience in analytics is more around based into Microsoft technologies. Mm-hmm. But I worked on Azure, Databricks, Microsoft Power BI, PySpark, all those kind of things. But last year, I joined a new organization, Trustpilot, where I actually got exposure to learning something new, which is apart from Microsoft platform, it was more around Google Cloud platform, mm-hmm. working on BigQuery, doing visualization in a tool called Looker. So I worked there for a few months, and then I think something was missing was I was not very much close to my passion, because what mm-hmm. I feel is your job should be in the industry where you can make your passion meet your job as well. So I just thought of coming back to Microsoft platform. And last month, I joined Avanade as a senior consultant here in London. So here where they use all the Microsoft techs, which I'm, crazy about and love working on. So that's what my whole analytics journey so far. So that's what here I am, basically.
Awesome. Congrats on the new job, by the way. I have friends who work at Avanade who just have nothing but great things to say about it too.
Yeah. It's an amazing company, right? And amazing people in the team. So just loving it so far.
I think that's a really good point for those who, when you start a new job, I guess it's that fear of it's not for me, but I've just started. And is it a bad thing if I leave? And, is it going to look bad if I've only done it for a few months? People question mm-hmm. why and so on. But I think that's such a good message of if it's not right for you, if it's not your passion, you're wasting time if you stay longer than you should.
Exactly, because job should not be like, you know, like you're just doing it because you have to do it and earn money. It should be more, very much close to what you love doing. So I think that was something I had different in my mind. No, my passion is for Microsoft technology, especially Power BI. So I really want to work on that. Yeah, it was a hard decision, though everything at Trustpilot was really great for me. Amazing team members, amazing learning. But yeah, I had to take the hard decision because I really wanted to do which I'm passionate about. So yeah. I sometimes good to take those hard decisions, I think.
Yeah,
it is. And I think the tide is changing, right? Where we have this mentality of we have to stay with the company because we've been here for a long time, right? The sunk cost fallacy is that we've put in a lot of time here. We have to be loyal to this company because we've had this job. But like you're saying, like at the end of the day, if it doesn't serve us, let's go somewhere where it does. And we do something that we enjoy. And I think that also makes productive employees, right?
Exactly.
It's healthy. You're exercising your brain and your skills and everything else. Like, love the message here.
Definitely. I mean, talking about passion and, you know, for the Microsoft technologies, congratulations on becoming MVP.
Thank you, guys.
And it was recently, was it, that you were nominated?
It was basically in March 2021. So it's going to be a year now that I have got my MVP. So I was nominated in December 2020 for all the community efforts I do. And then, yeah, luckily I got my MVP in March 2021 after 3 months. So yeah, it's going to be a year now, basically.
Can you tell us a little bit about that journey? What's changed since becoming MVP?
Yeah, actually getting nominated for an MVP was the biggest thing I got in my life, basically, because if I tell you a little background, how I became an MVP was, I started contributing to Microsoft Power BI community because 7 years back, I was someone like everyone who's into Power BI field. I mean, it was more like Power BI was just coming up. So we were trying to learn things, right? And obviously Power BI community is a forum where you not only help others, but you also learn a lot from the community. So that's where I started my journey. So my main motive was never being an MVP. I never knew what an MVP is. I came to know about it when I got nominated for it. So I was contributing in the community more for learning stuff. And obviously I started helping few people after a few months because I had a good learning curve there. So I just started contributing to the community. So just started helping people with all the Power BI queries they have. I started writing a few blogs as well on community that actually gave me a little bit of more motivation and confidence around things that I was learning. And yeah, I think after a contribution of, after a more than a year or so, so if you guys know, Greg Dickler is one of the old MVP, I would say, in Power BI field. I mean, he's a very knowledgeable person and one of my inspiration as well. So he nominated me for all the contributions I did in Microsoft Power BI community. And yeah, nominated me as an MVP, came to know about MVP through him, like what an MVP is. And you know, what's actually the role of an MVP? It's not just about, you know, posting things or, you know, making people aware. There's a bigger responsibility. So yeah, basically he nominated me. I got my MVP in March 2021. And I think suddenly something really changed. The day I got my MVP, I was just getting more and more approach from different user groups, different conferences, like, come on, Pragati, can you speak about Power BI? We have seen your work in Power BI community. You are pretty active on LinkedIn. You keep on sharing your knowledge within your network. So will you come and, you know, start talking about things? So this is something I never did before. But after March 2021, things suddenly changed. I started getting involved into more community efforts by, you know, speaking at different conferences, user groups, making people aware of about what Power BI can do, presenting different use cases. So mostly my Power BI sessions are more around the introductory sessions. So anyone who wants to get started with Power BI, so come and attend my sessions because they're more around the introductory one, because I still feel people really need to know what Power BI is capable of rather than just jumping to the advanced topics. So I think that's what has changed after being an MVP. And yeah, just don't want to miss mentioning, like, I actually am in contact with some of the amazing people around the world who are MVPs. And, you know, just seeing their work, I mean, it just inspires me and motivates me, you know, keep continuing with these kind of contributions. So yeah, that's what I really love about the MVP community.
Amazing. I highly relate to the, I was just minding my own business and here somebody nominated me for MVP, right? Like I just got mine in December of 2021.
Wow, congratulations.
Thank you. I mean, not to make this about me, but a lot of the things that you were saying, same exact thing. It was, I was minding my business. I wanted to learn. I wanted to bring others on this journey, which I think that is the spirit of being an MVP, right? Not that you were gunning for the award. And I think honestly, that's what makes some of the best MVPs is you were just doing your thing. You learned something really cool. You wanted to teach other people. And being in the beginner space, I remember being at conferences, watching the first conferences, because I do Power Automate and Power Apps. So I might learn a thing or two from you about Power BI. But I remember sitting in conferences, my first conferences, and be like, wow, this is so cool. These big, huge use cases. But how do you get started? Mm-hmm. And so I think being in that beginner space and giving the introduction is so empowering to users, to citizen developers to be like, oh, I can do this too. Exactly. Instead of just being like, oh, I have to be in tech. I have to be a dev. I have to have had some sort of background to have this knowledge. And that's not it at all. It's you meet one person.
Yeah, exactly. Because I mean, there are many knowledgeable people in the industry. I mean, I really learn a lot attending many of those sessions. But sometimes I really feel because many of my connections on LinkedIn, I've got so many followers on LinkedIn, but still they come back to me and ask me, Pragati, how to get started with Power BI? So that's the majority of questions I get asked from people. So that's why, I mean, not just boasting about the number of sessions I've done, but it's really a good thing. Like in last 1 year, I did nearly 24 sessions between 7 months, but all those sessions, if you see, are around basics of Power BI. And people really loved it because I have seen there are many blogs, there are amazing YouTube tutorials out there, but sometimes people really need someone to, you know, tell them in a live, you know, conference, either virtually or in person, like, come on, you do these things, because that sometimes creates a different kind of impact. So that's what I think I really like to do. If I'm doing something really good for the community, it will only give me a satisfaction if it's creating a good impact on the people. So that's why when I started getting those questions, I was like, no, I'm not going for advanced sessions because there are already people doing that.
Yeah.
And they're doing amazing jobs.
So true.
I go for beginner sessions and make people aware more about how to get started. So I think that's what my concern is about, contributing to the community.
Okay. I feel a collab with us in the future for a conference. So we're going to do beginner session of Power Automate and Power BI. We'll talk offline.
Do you know what? That would be so good.
I'm in.
Let's do it.
I want to watch it because I specialize in teams and I'm now looking at obviously adaptive cards and Power Automate. Fine.
Let's but go, Kat.
Power
You're
BI.
We can include.
I don't. No,
we can
I
include
watch
teams.
It,
we can include teams in the use case. Come on, create a Power BI report.
Do it in teams.
I love Power Apps form. Share it over Teams with the users. That's a complete use case.
We got
so,
it.
Kat, three of us can do a session.
There we are.
We can do it. I love adaptive
watch
cards.
Watch this space, everyone. Watch this space.
Just watch for us. We are going to blow up.
That does lead me on, actually. Do you prefer doing conferences and presenting in person, or do you prefer doing it online?
So when I started my speaking journey, obviously, in this pandemic world, it didn't allow us to be in person and, you know, deliver these kind of sessions. So I have been doing so far virtual sessions. But yeah, this year, my first in-person conference is going to be in June, which is in Croatia. So I'll be basically going to Croatia to deliver a session for Data Saturdays Croatia. So that's going to be my in-person first event. But yeah, I have got a few more lined up till June, which are virtual. So yeah, I've got a few more things coming up this year.
Amazing. What about you, Azure?
For in-person conferences? I have only done, and this is something I think I might have talked about when I first came on the show, is everything has been virtual for me. Yeah. I have met, I think, three people in the greater Microsoft community in person. And it's been so weird because it almost feels as if like, oh, I've been I've been playing in my computer for the past couple of years, right? And so I'm, am I allowed to speak about this? But I've got invited. I got invited
go for
to
it.
Speak at, okay, we're going to go for it. I got invited to speak at DynamicsCon in September. Nice. So that's going to be in Texas. So it'll still be in the US, but it will be my first in-person engagement since the pandemic, right? Because I started my journey in like December of 2019. So there was never any in-person interaction for me at all. So it's going to be a little weird, but I'm also really excited at the same time to get the full experience too.
Yeah. I think I definitely think in-person is going to be something really a different kind of experience. I mean, though virtual is a great way to, you know, share your knowledge and meet people, but I think in person will have a different impact. So I myself is quite excited for my first in-person event. So yeah, let's see how it goes.
Feel like virtual has provided us a lot more opportunities than we probably would have even pre-pandemic, right? Because like you're doing user groups in different countries. I remember when I did one out of South America and I was like, oh, this is actually really cool to be able to connect with folks all over the globe. And I can do it from the comfort of my own home. And I don't know if it would have been the same experience with in-person conferences. Like, I can't wait to be in person for sure. But I think it's opened so many other doors and so many more connections just because people can just log into their computer and watch us and start doing their thing and reach out to us online.
Yeah, exactly. I think that's the biggest benefit. Sitting at your home, you're getting connected to people worldwide. So that's amazing.
I'm wearing pajama pants and I love this. So
in my own comfort zone, right?
In my own comfort zone. It's great.
It is.
You've also been on the other side of that though, in terms of conferences. So you're an organizer, is that right? Data Weekender, is it called?
Yes. So last year, I got an opportunity to become the part of Data Weekender as an organizer. So I was approached by the existing organizer, like if I can, you know, join them as an organizer for the conference. So yes, I did organize my first Data Weekender last year, 6th November 2021. And that was an amazing experience because obviously organizing event really need a lot of preparation, right? Because it's because when you are a speaker, you just are, you know, you have to just take care of your session, your timing, you need to prepare that and just present it, right? But when you are an organizer, it's like a lot of effort in that. I mean, you get like hundreds of sessions from different speakers, then you've got like, you have to select which one speakers you are going to give chance to, because all of these sessions are amazing, but you have to make hard choices, right? So that's, I think, one of the biggest thing I've learned, I mean, as an organizer. Come on, this is a tough job. But yeah, it has been an amazing experience because I got to interact with some new people because there are so many volunteers as well involved apart from us as an organizers, and they do a brilliant job helping us out and, you know, just getting this conference done. So yeah, it has been an amazing, you know, experience as an organizer as well. And yeah, we do have next Data Weekender coming on 14th May this year. So yeah, if any of you guys want to speak, let me know. Our CFS is still open, so you can submit sessions.
Great. What did you say, the 14th of May?
Yeah, so let me...
It's coming up?
Yeah, it's coming up. So our, you know, session submission is still open for people. So if you guys are still, you know, looking for any conferences where you really want to speak, and you know, or maybe if you want to start your speaking journey, Data Weekender is a great platform, guys, because we promote new speakers and we have proper mentors who can mentor you for, you know, for your first session. And I would really ask women to come up, please. I mean, please, women.
Yeah. But more women on
submit sessions and submit sessions at the conference, because I really want women to come forward and speak, have their voice. So yeah, please.
What type of content then for the speakers who might be looking in? What are you looking for in terms of?
So basically, Data Weekender is a more data platform conference. So you can speak about SQL Server, you can speak about Azure sessions, you can speak about database administration, you can talk about Power BI, you can talk about maybe C sharp. I mean, it's anything related to a Microsoft technology. So you can choose whatever you are good at on a Microsoft platform and just submit a session. It could be a team session, like for example, bring in a Power BI report and share it in Microsoft Teams with your teams. So those kind of things. Or if you want to present something within Teams area, that's also welcome. So yeah, we welcome any session within Microsoft technology.
All right. Awesome. I think we'll put that link in the YouTube at the bottom, the comment section. But also, if you want to put out a tweet, we're happy to amplify too and be calling out junior data analysts that we are looking for you. I think that's one thing is getting, you know, into conferences. I remember when I went to my first Women in Tech like meetup group and they're like, you should do a conference. And I was like, me? Like I'm a baby, but it's so important to show like this is how you get experience. This is how you get the mentoring. Like there is space for everyone here and people need to know that. Women, we're shouting you out. Please come.
Yeah, join us. I think this virtual life just made things more easier for women because me as a woman, I know what challenges we have when we have to balance our work life with our home life as well, right? So, but this pandemic just gave us that opportunity, like sitting in our own comfort, we can actually start our speaking if we really want to go into that line. And it's like an amazing opportunity. So that's why I always say like, women, come forward. This is the time you can, you know, actually focus on your career when you are sitting in your own comfort zone. So yeah, please come forward and submit sessions, I would say.
I was going to, one of my questions that wasn't on like the agenda was going to ask, how do you balance all of this at the same time? Because you were busy. I looked at LinkedIn and I was like, your highlights reel, there was so much going on. So how do you balance doing all of these community activities and finding time for yourself and family? What helps you keep it all together and what helps you relax?
I think, honestly, it's not easy for us to do that. And I mean, it's not just for women, it's for men as well, because those people doing that amazing job out there for the community is not something easy, because when we guys are in a 9-to-6 job or 9-to-5 job, we are already working for those 10, 11 hours. And then when we are doing these community efforts, they actually take a lot of time. But I think for me, what actually worked is my passion about, you know, helping people and, you know, because this community has given me a lot. I started as a learner a few years back. So somehow I really wanted to give back to the community in a way I can. I mean, it was not like I really want to create a huge impact, but some kind of impact, some kind of things what I can help the community with. So, I mean, if I just say like how many hours I do, it's just like an hour after my work, what I do. So weekly, I just try to give like 5 to 6 hours. And suppose if any of the conferences are coming up, then I generally use my weekends for that, because obviously that's a big event. So I have to invest more time in it. But yeah, Sundays are generally free for me. I literally don't do anything on Sundays. Sometimes I just don't cook food as well. I just order or just ask my husband to do that for me. So yeah, Sundays are literally free for me. I even don't check my LinkedIn or Twitter that day. I'm like away from the phone. But sometimes Monday to Friday are challenging, but still it is doable. If you really have that kind of passion, if you have that motivation towards giving back to the community, what community has given you, then I think 1 hour is kind of doable. And especially when we are not, I mean, we are still in the virtual world, right? We are not traveling to office on the daily basis, because especially in London, if you start traveling, 1 hour is like one side travel to your workplace. So. Yeah. Now you're not traveling, so rather utilize that 1 hour in giving back to the community or just doing the extra community efforts, what you really want to do. So yeah, that's how I really like to balance. I mean, try to put that balance in my life.
I love that the fact that you've given a time as well, because I think with most people, it's how much is too much? How much is, you know, too much to get you burnt out and managing time? And that's something that I struggled with for quite a while, is managing work and then extra activities, and I was quite overwhelmed and I was like, oh my god, and I was just saying yes to everything. I think that's so helpful. That's such good advice. Spend an hour at the end, in the time that you would typically be on the train, that virtual commute, if anybody is a Viva fan, but you have that just 1 hour, and packaging it like that just feels it's only that hour after,
because,
and it's some stuff you enjoy as well.
Yeah, exactly. And it kind of gives you a break from your daily work schedule as well. Mm-hmm. Like, for example, I'm working for a client. I'm stuck in a problem. Come on, after six, I don't need to care about it because 6 to 7, I'm doing something else. So it kind of gives me a break as well. So
yeah.
That's why I really love doing it after my work hours. Okay, mm-hmm. I need to take break from my 9 hours job. Let's do something else. So yeah, it's a good practice. I mean, just don't spend like 2-3 hours. Spend just an hour daily. That's enough, actually.
The bite-sized chunks, that's great. I mean, even when you're learning, it's the same kind of thing, right? Like you don't need to devote all your free time to it.
Exactly.
But just a little bit of time here and there. And I love the idea that you proactively take Sundays off to do
that. I do need it.
It's so
but we're
helpful.
Filming this on a Sunday, so sorry, we've been interrupted.
No, that's fine because it's not like I'm delivering a technical session today. It's more like a casual catch-up, right? So it's very much different to when we're doing into technical area. Like suppose if I had a conference today, it would be like, okay, yesterday was Saturday and tomorrow I'll start my work again, and today I'm doing a conference. Looked like that. But I think everyone needs some time, because if you are doing so many things, especially after work hours, if you're doing other stuff as well, then you really need that kind of break, especially your mind. Otherwise, you will just get tired of doing stuff. Maybe you'll give up one day. So rather than try to balance it that way.
Yeah, there's an internet therapist that I follow on Instagram. Her name is Nedra Tawab. And she put out like a short video last week that was talking about self-care, right? And I think some self-care has been like, oh, you're going to go get your nails done. Oh, you're going to, you know, do this. Oh, you're going to do that. But she was like, no, really, it's this idea of you are proactively taking care of yourself, that self-care isn't supposed to be a reactionary thing. It's supposed to prevent you from getting to this burnout, from getting to this overwhelmed point. And I was like, just that simple reframing. Maybe we kind of already knew this or should have known this, but I thought it was really pertinent just to hear it out loud. Because I know for myself, I schedule weekends where it's like, I don't want to plan anything for this one weekend a month that is going to be mine. If something comes up, right, I can say yes. But I like the idea of, okay, well, Sundays are going to be my rest days. I may not even cook.
Yeah, I actually don't do that. I mean, it's an honest thing I'm telling you. I literally don't cook on Sunday. It's like I'm on complete rest, or I take care of myself. It's more like that. So, and I think it's important, because you have a lot of stuff when you're staying at home over the weekdays as well. Mm-hmm. Come on, when I used to go to work, I didn't have to wash a coffee mug as well. But now I'm staying whole day in my, in my house. I literally have to wash like 4 coffee mugs just for myself. Then obviously my husband also takes coffee. So we end up having so many utensils. So come on, guys, we have got a lot of work at home these days.
My mom and I were talking about this recently, because I was like, I don't feel like I've been this messy of a person. I was like, I don't remember this being a thing. And she's like, remember, you are working from home and work is your priority. You are not home to have time to clean the house.
Exactly.
So when you're doing, when you're quickly grabbing lunch, I recently switched job roles, but a lot of times it would be like, I'm eating lunch like at my desk. And then it'll be like, I just have to go toss the plate in the sink and then I'll worry about it later. Right. And so she's like, remember, you're not home to be doing things around the house. It is you are actually at work and you're living in your environment at the same time. You are making more messes than you would be at work, where maybe you just take your lunch with you and you're like, okay, whatever the contents of my lunchbox are is what's going to come home with me. Not
exactly
3 meals a day and extra snacks and everything else. Or like me, I wear robes and socks and everything too. So
I think it's kind of good, right? You're attending meeting. You can turn off your camera and have a fruit salad.
Exactly.
You don't get that kind of luxury when you're in the office, right? Because you are in the meeting room with your teammates. You can't have a fruit salad in front of them.
I totally would. That's me. I'll be like, guys, I got to preface. I've been meetings all day. This is my only time I'm going to. So I will be eating. I'll put myself on mute, but I will be eating here. Or when we were in the office, I would definitely bring my lunch to meetings. Be like, I haven't had time and I'm not going to starve myself today. Yes. So I just won't bring anything that's going to be like a bother to the rest of the group. I might want to distract them with some really good pasta or something, but and now even camera on, like as long as I'm not with a client, I'm in my new role that we have cameras on for all meetings. I think it's just kind of understood that, okay, we all need a break at some point. Yeah. And so, you know, take that.
And I think everyone respects that as well. I mean, if you like, for example, I mean, it's a real thing, guys. I take a 1 hour lunch break every day. Mm-hmm. So I cook fresh meal. I mean, both me and my husband take that hour off. Both of us cook our meal, have it, and then go back to work. So that's how, because sometimes you really need that. And most of my meetings are like in the first half of the day. So I'm literally, half of my brain is drained because of those clients' meetings. Yes. And I'm like, no, I'm going away for an hour. So sometimes if my lunch is already cooked, I go for a walk, or maybe I can just go and watch something on the TV, which I like, and then just come back. So it's like, take a relaxation break and then come back to work. So
One thing that I've been really, like, as a New Year thing is, I don't get outside enough and exercise and walk and enough than I should be doing. So I love now that I dedicate that hour in the middle of the day and I will go outside for a walk. Yeah. And it just, if you have any kind of, you know, you have meetings in the morning, you're in a workshop and it's just intense and you're stressed and anxious, it just gets rid of it. You go out, I put in a podcast, and there's some tech podcasts that I listen to, but I also started listening to a murder podcast, my favorite murder. And so now I'm just terrified walking, like, is someone following me? Walking through these woods with my murder podcast in. And the girl was traumatized, and it was just, but it's just a little bit of reality switch off for just like an hour. Yeah. Go out, come back, and I just, it changes everything. You feel like you're starting a new day. I'm like, right, the afternoon, right, let's do it. And it just, so the hour, if you, sometimes I can't, but I always try to make that, just get outside, and then I can start afresh. I'm more productive in the afternoon as well if I do that. So, but these are the benefits of working at home, I think, as well as being able to. And I love the fact that everybody's become more of a human. We've got kids running in the background, there's dogs, there's, you know, somebody's at the door, there's all of these things that I just think make us more human. And it builds, like, in the office, you'd be in a suit sitting there and everyone's yada yada yada. Whereas now we've got personalities,
pajamas and
you know, people just a bit more relaxed and less formal, which builds better relationships. So I think it's positive, if anything, but it's good fun.
Definitely.
I did want to ask a little bit about some of the technology that you specialize in. So I was looking at your blog, and again, we'll put the link to your blog in the show notes as well. Data Vibe, is it? Is that the?
Yes.
Amazing. So it's got some really great articles for anybody looking for content on Power BI, SQL, Azure. There's a huge amount of stuff on there for exams, lots of content there. This is all stuff that I'm not familiar with. So I was kind of looking at them and I was like, oh, okay, let's try and learn something new. Can you tell us a little bit about, in terms of the favorite technology that you have, is there a favorite solution, a favorite feature that you have, or is there something, a technology that you prefer to write about, any of those? What's your
I think obviously my favorite tool or technology that I'd really want to work or work on is Power BI, because that's where my passion lies. I mean, everything what I have been doing for the last few years is on Power BI, and I really want to learn more and more, because Power BI is a tool, like, every month they come up with new updates and it's like hard to keep up with those updates. So that's where my actual passion lies, and that's the tool I really like to work on, and especially whatever learnings I share about, it's always on Power BI these days. So yeah, that's the tool which I like. And yeah, then coming back to your question, like something which is like a favorite technology or solution in favorite, basically trick or, you know, solution in the technology. Yeah. I think in Power BI, I really love the buttons and bookmarks tricks, because that's the kind of, you know, functionality in Power BI which can actually take your reports to a different level and give user an amazing experience when they're seeing your dashboards or reportings online. But yeah, obviously, as we know, like, Power BI team is doing a great job at Microsoft bringing something new every month, but sometimes those kind of things doesn't suit your use cases. So I would really love if they can improve a few things around buttons and bookmark usage in Power BI. So yeah, that's what something I would like them to do.
How do you keep up with the updates then if they change every month? That's one thing I always get asked, but with Teams, it's the same thing. It changes constantly. So What would you suggest people do to keep up with changes? We can't know everything, obviously, but.
No. So like every month, Power BI brings like 10 or 20 updates. Obviously, I can't keep myself updated with all of them because sometimes I'm not working in a use case where those updates might help me. But what I generally do is like for example, most of my role is around, you know, designing a solution for reporting for the user. So what I try to keep myself updated with is more around the visual changes that Power BI brings in every month. Like for example, sometime back, they bought something like Page Navigator or Bookmark Navigator. So I tried to implement them in the existing reports where I had buttons and bookmarks in Power BI. So I can see and explore what that new thing has impacted my report in a way. Then obviously, I mean, there could be few things like what new visuals are coming up, have they modified anything in the existing visuals, or like in Power BI, they bought this new format pane sometime back, which is like, not everyone is, you know, using that because it's kind of a different view to that pane. So those kind of things, I really don't keep up with every update, Kat. I mean, it's more like what I am interested in and what could fit in the use cases I'm currently working on. So yeah, that's what I target basically.
Yeah, that makes sense.
I have a question about updates because like with Power Automate, sometimes it's, you know, the newsletter will come out and they have features, but some things are so specific, like to a connector, right? We have over 500 connectors. It'll just be, I'll pop in and be like, oh, that's new. Is Power BI like that as well, where you discover something that may not have been announced?
Not yet.
Okay.
Not yet. But yeah, mostly they bring up those kind of updates like a month before, or they just announce it like, okay, these are the new things we are bringing in Power BI. Like, not sure if you guys have heard about the Wave 3 plan for Power Platform that Microsoft released this month, I guess. So they'll start bringing in some new features in even Power Automate, Power Apps, Power BI from April 2021. So they have released a plan what new features they are going to bring out on Power Platform from April 2021. So I think they are very specific about what they're announcing. It has never happened before. Like they added something to Power BI, but they never announced it before.
Okay.
Or they haven't written it in a blog. So they keep sure, I mean, they make sure like whatever they are showing is something already written in their update blog with the Power BI features. Okay.
Yeah, sometimes I'm like,
so sorry, just like I was gonna say, I bet you're just like, damn, I should have worked in Power BI now because I have to tell you when there's an update.
I have written flows before where I'm like, oh, I wish this would have been a feature, right? In a connector. And then I don't know, I'm playing around with something and be like, huh, they put in a new new version of the connector, right? And you wouldn't have known otherwise, because there's so many connectors, which I love it. But I'm like, wait, what does this version do? And you open it up and you're like, oh, that's really neat. I remember maybe it was last year or year before, Planner in Teams, it used to be that there was only a subset of like flags that you could name. And then they put like all 25 or 26 colors that you could do that. Yeah. So just different little features. There was one that I remember, I was like, oh, there's like, that's a big one that I wished I could have used. And so sometimes I'm like, oh, it's nice to just pop in and figure it out. But I'm like, oh, this would have been nice to have known beforehand. But yeah, it doesn't quite delve into that. So it'll just be, sometimes I'll poke around and just to see if there's anything new. Yeah. I love that too. Sometimes it's just a nice surprise.
I think sometimes the new features, what they bring out, they just blow your mind. Oh, come on, how can this be possible? I mean, how can they bring these things? And it's like you just can't hold yourself back before trying them. I mean, sometimes when the new Power BI update comes that night, I literally sit for an hour and see, oh, come on, these new things are there. Let me try it, how they work, so that from tomorrow I can actually, you know, use them or start using them for any client reporting I'm working on. So yeah, sometimes though some features are quite interesting that you just spend night exploring them and fitting them in a use case. So
here we were saying that only spend an hour doing this after work. And, okay, we all lied here. Sometimes we know.
But I think those things those things are more like, okay, you have got time and you really want to do it.
Yeah.
Here. But
it's not every night, is it?
So it's not every night.
Balance.
Yeah, it's not every night.
But talking about Power BI, you are the manager of the Power BI user group for the UK. And that was that pretty recent that you started that role?
So that was as well something last year, mid of the year, I think. So Leon Gordon, who's basically the owner of the group, he approached me like, would you like to contribute to this group as a manager? So I was like, yeah, because that could be a good experience. Because this group is like, I think one of the LinkedIn groups that has really grown fast. So we have got so many members of the group. And the group is quite good. I mean, if you go to the group on LinkedIn, it has got pretty good content, not just about Power BI, Power Automate, Power Apps. People post about database administration there as well. And obviously, sometimes you could see some job postings as well there. And like these days, I've seen people are really promoting few of their YouTube channels with amazing tips and tricks on different kind of platform. So you can have a lot of content there, and you can have a lot of learning opportunity in the group. So that's why I really love these kind of things. Now I'm trying to promote few people in the group. Come on, this YouTube video is really good. So come on, guys, see it. Or this job posting is available. Job is available. Come on, if you're interested, then go and apply for it. So those kind of things are, pretty good in the group. And I think Leon also organizes some visualization challenges on monthly basis, and that's pretty good thing if someone is really, want to start working on reporting or dashboarding. So we just announced some kind of free data sets that are available online. You can bring that data set in Power BI and try to create some kind of reports and present it. And even it has got paid prize or something. I think it has got Amazon. So you can basically win Amazon vouchers if you win the challenge. So I think that challenge comes up every month, if I'm not wrong. So pretty good group, actually. You get to do a lot of stuff, a lot of learning. Amazing.
And it's for beginners as well, in terms of beginners who are looking to speak and just learn about the technology as well. So it's both beginners.
Exactly. And even our Power BI UK user group, I mean, if you are interested in speaking, you can approach us, because we organize weekly sessions with the different speakers every Thursday evening. So if any of you guys are really interested in speaking, want to start your speaking journey, most welcome. Women, most welcome. Come forward. I mean, anyone, please come forward for speaking. I mean, we always look for speakers there. Let us know. You can contact me on LinkedIn if you're really interested in, speaking. I'll definitely get you there on the group.
Amazing. I love this. This is like such the true spirit of community. I love it. It's amplifying other people, right? Like signal boosting them, and also being like, here are job opportunities. Come to this user group. It's opening the floor up for people who don't quite know where to start, and you're giving them just like, here's the foundation. Like, just
There are many people, they keep on posting stuff about not just Power BI, different technologies as well. And people, I mean, even I keep on answering some questions. Like, sometimes people post their queries as well in the group. Come on in Power BI, I'm trying to do this. Can you help me? So there are people, not just me, helping with the queries as well. So that group has become like a forum of opportunities and learnings, basically. Mm-hmm. So if you guys are interested, I mean, you should definitely join the group, because I'm 100% sure you'll benefit in some way from the group.
I'm ready to travel over to London. Let's go.
You should.
Virtual trip. Be like, hey, mom, I'm in London today. She'd be like, virtually, but I'm still there. I'm with my friend. I'm hanging out with my friends.
Amazing. Well, we'll put the your LinkedIn and the Power BI user group link below. So you'll be able to see it for those who are watching who want to get involved. And that's it. I like the idea of putting job opportunities as well. So it's bettering people and, this is in our area. So this is just useful stuff.
Yes.
So that's absolutely amazing. So pop all that information below if you want to check it out. Anybody who's watching, and me included, going to go on there and start dabbling into you guys' area now. So really excited. I was going to say what the obviously, we're talking about the technology. We talked about your kind of career journey. What about outside of community and outside of work? What do you do in your spare time? What's your hobby?
I think mostly. I actually love traveling, guys. So I mean, traveling is just not like outside country. It could be everywhere. Like I've got pretty good area in. I mean, I actually live in Surrey, which is one of the most beautiful area in UK.
Yeah.
So if you walk like for an hour or 40 minutes, you get to see very beautiful sceneries around here. So I really like to go outside and, you know, link myself with the nature sometimes. So that's something I do. But yeah, as a hobby, I actually call myself a techie artist. So those of you have attended my sessions before, you could have seen me introducing myself as a techie artist, because painting is my hobby. And I've actually got my own Instagram channel, you know, dedicated.
Let's drop to this it. Painting. Give us the account. So, we want to see it.
So that's basically what I, you know, like to do in my free time.
And amazing.
Yeah, it's just a hobby, yeah. But yeah, I love doing it, because sometimes, you know, painting just takes me to a different world. Mm-hmm. And and especially colors, they just help me relax and, you know, mm-hmm. calm down in a certain way. So I don't have to worry about anything, not about my work, not about anything what I'm doing for the community. Mm-hmm. I'm just in my own world doing something else. Mm-hmm. So I really love doing painting, because sometimes it's kind of meditation for me as well. So that's why I like to be among colors doing something. So yeah, that's
amazing.
What I do.
How long have you been painting for?
Actually, I've been doing it for some time, but I think the pandemic really gave me an opportunity. Yeah. Because I was getting more time apart from my work, because earlier I used to travel to my workplace. So obviously it takes a lot of time. So I think now I've been doing it continuously from last 3 years or so, because now this virtual pandemic has given us more time in our life. So yeah, mm-hmm. I just try to do it when the weather is bad. Like today, the weather is not good. Maybe mm-hmm. after the show, I'll just go and do something. Because I'm not going outside.
Yeah.
I'll do something. So yeah, it just helps me in relaxation. So yeah. As a therapy also, I like to do it.
Okay. Yeah, I think the therapeutic thing, I could definitely see that. Because you do your crocheting, Azure, don't you? Do you think that's the same thing?
Yeah.
Is it therapeutic? Does it chill you out? And
it does. Yeah. I think I find myself, my brain will run like task manager, right? And it just constantly runs. Sometimes it's thinking out problems to solve. And this is just meditation. I can do this while I have music on, while I'm watching a show, right? While we're doing this, and it helps me focus a little bit more too. So I'm not thinking about some other business problem, et cetera, et cetera. And it's nice to have that alternate outlet where you can kind of just like get lost in it.
Yeah. And I think everyone should have something like that. Maybe mm-hmm. if you're into reading, or if you're into mm-hmm. hiking, go outside, or, you know, mm-hmm. painting, singing, music, anything. But I think everyone needs that kind of, you know, switch in their mind. Mm-hmm. Like, okay, you're switching off your work mode, but you're going into your mm-hmm. maybe hobby mode. So mm-hmm. it just gives you a different energy or different environment. Mm-hmm. I think everyone should pursue something. Yeah.
I think it mine's a little bit darker than yours. I'm really into like murder stuff. So
murder stuff.
So is it like murder?
You like watching?
Yeah,
that.
And okay. podcasts and reading up about all the different serial killers and.
I think that's weird. I think we need to do something else too. We need to just add something else in there a little bit later.
We need something happier.
I think if Kat is just not,
like,
you know.
I'm like, oh, love it. Like, what did they do? And just a bit, I'm a bit weird.
I think I relax
as I put my, I'm like, oh, I need some serial killer documentary to like zone out and like meditate.
I think if you're not bringing this into action, it's a very good thing. Keep up with it.
No, I'm just a spectator of events.
Yeah, then it's amazing. Just don't act.
There is pop culture. I normally don't, I'm not, there's so many good shows out there and I get overwhelmed with the amount of shows, but if y'all have access to it, so there is as a friend was telling me, it's a spoof of like a true crime podcast, but there's a show on Hulu called Only Murders in the Building. And it's got Martin Short, Steve Martin, and Selena Gomez, like a really Martin Short and Steven Martin together. I've seen them in like Father of the Bride and really loved those movies like in the 90s. And they're in Selena Gomez, like, how is this going to work? But it is it's a comedy about murders that are happening in a building in Brooklyn, New York. And it's a whodunit. And
Yeah.
Fantastic. If you need something like light to watch, it's
that's
very,
still
very
murder
good.
Related.
That's still murder related, but yeah, it's light, yeah. It's comical, and the episodes are, you know, half an hour long, and there's only one season out. So I'm like, I can commit to that. Just because I was like, if it's, you know, five or six seasons, we're getting into territory. I'm like, I can't even start. But if you have the chance to watch it, I really, really enjoyed that one.
You must be loving Sherlock Holmes then, Kat.
Yeah. So which one?
There are so many.
Yeah, there's so many. I like that. I feel like they were a bit lighthearted though. I do like the dark stuff.
Oh, you like the dark side stuff. Okay.
Even then, I'm like, that's quite lighthearted, Sherlock Holmes.
But I think Azure, there should be a podcast having Kat as a,
talking about the murder documentary that I watched.
And I think
recently.
She should talk about what kind of stuff she really liked.
Well, like only Murders in a Building is like a spoof of a true crime podcast.
Oh,
so
okay.
Kat, you now can make your own podcast giving your own analysis of the podcast.
You could actually start with one.
You could.
Do you know what? We're opening up different avenues now. So watch out, guys. There might be a rival podcast going on.
Or we just take a part of Cloud Conversations.
Yeah,
just
the last 20 minutes.
Yeah, it's just, dedicated to what so Kat funny. Likes. And just talk about it.
I like
anyone else who likes murder.
Art corner. Yes, we're showcasing everything.
I love it. We've all got things that we're into. That's what makes us special. I think we'll end on the murder or on the murder thing.
I have a question. Okay, I know we've been doing the Terminator, one or two question every so often. I want to ask you, what is your favorite song? I feel like we need a Cloud Conversations podcast, like mishmash of songs. So Pragati, what are you listening today that inspires you, that you like, that you dance around your living room to?
Today? Or any day?
Any day. What is a bop that you really like right now?
Actually, I'm an Indian, so I'm too much into Indian songs. So
let's bring it
one
to
of
us.
My favorite singers actually passed away a few days back. So I'm actually listening to Lata Mangeshkar's song. She's a very big celebrity for India, and okay. I've been listening to her songs from last few days because she has been like a icon and inspiration to me as well. Mm-hmm. The kind of singing she has done in her entire career, so I think she is the one. I'm listening to her songs these days.
Okay.
Amazing.
Yeah. And yesterday evening, somehow, I don't know, on YouTube, it came to my feed. I Am the Woman song. Have you heard that song?
No.
Yeah. I am woman. I am fada. Is it that one?
No, it's a different one. And that song is taken into the movie Sex and the City as well.
Okay.
If you guys have watched, I love that movie, actually.
I have not watched it.
You should watch it. That movie is based on four girlfriends, basically, and they try to travel world. They have got so much into their life and mm-hmm. how they tackle their work and life balance, those kind of things. So it's something like I am a woman, something like that. Sorry, I'm not good at singing, but
either am I.
You're
a bard.
It's an amazing song. I love listening it sometimes.
Okay,
if you feel demotivated,
yeah, we'll put it on the track. I feel like we should start like this. I don't know if it's actually going to take off, but I'm going to try.
Yeah, I'll just put the link so you guys can listen it.
Yeah.
It's a pretty old song and it has been taken in many movies. Okay. So.
Is it Helen Reddy? Is that the one?
Yeah, yeah.
Right. I mean, I've just Googled it. That's why I saw the name. I didn't just know that.
I think I heard that song first time in that Sex and the City second part movie, and I really liked it, the way they sang it.
Okay.
So if you're feeling demotivated, ladies, just go and listen that song. It's a nice song.
We've learned something new. I'm going to go. I bet you will hear it and be like,
actually, we probably have heard that before, right?
Yes.
My brain doesn't remember artists, so.
Yeah. Mine either. I use Google and that. Amazing. Well, thank you so much for coming on the show, Pragati. It was so nice to chat to you in Azure, first episode together. Woohoo. But we won't take any more of your Sunday, which is supposed to be your rest day, and let you do some painting. But is there anything, before we close the show, is there anything you want to end on, share with the audience, plug? This is your plug moment.
I think, first of all, I really enjoyed being here, and especially, you know, catching up and chatting about everything except the work thing. Yeah. As you're on Cats, it was great to meet you guys and talk to you. And yeah, I think people just keep liking my work on LinkedIn.
Yeah.
That's what, because when you guys like it and comment it, that adds a motivation mm-hmm. to me, adding more and sharing more. So yeah, just keep liking what you guys are doing. Not just me, there are so many community people out there. So yeah. Just amazing. Keep doing that.
I'll keep looking out for that Wordle score on Twitter too, because I see you've been playing Wordle.
Yeah.
Like, oh, yeah. Wonder how many she got today.
Yeah, I have to do that. I just realized I didn't do it today.
I've seen that pop up everywhere.
It's because of my husband that I'm doing, because he started doing it and he actually reads a lot of stuff. So his vocabulary is much way too better than me. And I thought maybe I can just start doing it. So yeah,
yes.
It's because of him I started doing.
Okay, maybe this has inspired me to start doing it too. Yes. So, and I've heard that it's not an addictive thing. Like you do it once a day and then that's it.
No,
like you have to wait till the next
it's
day.
Not.
So
yeah, cool. I mean,
okay,
it's
I can handle that.
I have seen people doing it like early in the morning at 4 a.m. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, come on, this needs to be something out of your work, relaxing you, not just taking your sleep away.
Yeah.
I sometimes miss it, especially on weekends. I don't mm-hmm. do it. Yeah, but today you just reminded me, I may just go and do it.
Yeah. only if you want to. This is self-care Sunday, rest up Sunday.
That's part of self-care, is yeah.
That's part of okay. Wordle is part of you heard it here first. Wordle is self-care.
Amazing. Right. Well, I mean, we share this on Twitter, and there's so many people on my Twitter as well who are just sharing their scores.
Yeah.
So, you know, everybody else on the Sunday, make sure you go and have a little go. It's all about improving your brain. And
yes,
your vocabulary.
Yes,
so it's all good. You're
and
learning.
You will learn some new words, basically.
There you are.
Yeah.
It's all self-care. Okay, well, follow us on Twitter at CloudCons365. Make sure you subscribe. If we get to 500 subscribers, there is going to be a prize. I don't know what the prize is, but Peter knows what the prize is. But you have to be subscribed to be within the draw. So please make sure that you subscribe, you like, you share. Check out all of the details that we put in the show notes to connect with Pragati or ask her any questions, join the user groups. And amazing. Thank you so much for coming on the show, Azure. It was absolutely amazing to do our first episode together. Look forward to many, many more.
Absolutely.
But yeah, we'll catch you on the next episode of Cloud Conversations. Have a great weekend, everyone. Thanks.
Take care.
Bye.